Ladies and gentlemen, poets and artists, welcome to the second annual Soaring Without Limits, Healing Through the Arts. As you know, if you've heard, it takes a village. Well, this took a city. Brockton, from where I'm from, very proud of. Brockton, of course, the Brockton Library, Brockton High, helped with the booklets. They printed all the booklets for us. And also, one of the Brockton High poets is represented in the exhibit. It is my pleasure to introduce the new director of the Brockton Public Library, Mr. Paul Engel.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for being here. Hi, and welcome. You know, it's really my honor to be able to stand before you today, and every time I get to do this, to kick off an event like this, it's just, it humbles me to no end. Yesterday I had a chance to come in here. This had just been set up. I was all alone. I have my own key to get in. And I came in with the intention of kind of walking around the room and taking in the art and then reading the poems. And I got overwhelmed, quite honestly. And these got in the way, too. I couldn't necessarily focus on one or the other. So what I did is I just took a seat in the middle of the room. And I just looked around. I just took in the art created by people who don't call themselves artists. And I said, you know, I'll get to the poems later. And that's what today's for, the poems. That's what the book's for. I really could not even imagine the stories behind these works of art. And the sheer tenacity of will. It was absolutely amazing. It was a great experience, as it is today for all of you. So as I stand here before you as the director of this fine library, I welcome each and every one of you to experience this room right now, to experience the poetry and the art that's here with us. And I just, you know, that's all I really want to say. I want to turn it over to Sandra, who's the director of the Southeastern Regional... I gave her a promotion. And thank you very much, everybody.
Very much. Well, thank you. I have a few thank yous first. First of all, thank you to Phil Hasoris, who actually organized the library for us and organized the poets. And I want to thank Paul for allowing us to be here in his beautiful library. And also the Brockton Library Foundation, who provided those wonderful refreshments outside. We have some honored guests here. We have the artists, who I will introduce in a minute. We have some people from our central and our western offices. Our colleagues from there came out just to see you special people. Now, I'm going to introduce the artists. Now, I want you to make some noise when I call your name. And this is in no order except the order that I found you in. First, we have Terry. Terry Sweeney and Linda Elmer. And Rob and Donna Bonia are over there, Rob. And Bob was here helping us set up this room on Saturday. In fact, Donna and Rob were both here as well. Tracy, where's Tracy?
She's outside.
Oh, she's outside. Okay. Tracy Tarvers is outside. Karen Dash is right here in front of us. And Elliot just left. He's probably out there. Elliot Doan, who did all these little cute things with the alcohol paint and some of the other things around here. He just left. And Beth, where's Beth? Beth Trell, back here. And Sandy de Morinville, where's Sandy? Right next to Beth, surprise. And we have Nathan Carr and Vicki Carr back there. Did anyone come in after that? Did I miss anybody?
Yes. Who?
Oh, Mark's here. Oh. This is Mark. And Mark's over there. Anybody else? I didn't know you came in. I'm sorry. Okay. A lot of you, when you came in, and this is here for show mostly, and I'm using this as a teaching experiment today. Everybody almost who saw this, what happened to you? Are you okay? What's wrong? And I'm thinking, I'm probably the least injured person in this room today, and I'm getting all this attention. And it's because people with brain injuries all look fine. That's the mantra, but don't you look great? But inside, lots of things happen. One of our clients described it as Swiss cheese. That, you know, you're going along fine, all of a sudden you hit one of the holes, and then, as Linda would say, they give you the change back in the department store or the grocery store, and they throw everything on your hand, uh-huh. And the change and the slips and everything, and you're standing there with your purse somewhere else. That's what it's like to have a brain injury. So how do you figure out if somebody has a brain injury, they're hurt worse than this? It just doesn't show. Okay, I'm going to start the poetry reading off with the poem from the middle mask up there, the blue one, and it's called The Blue Mask, and the mask is done by Amy Westgate, who was going to be here, but I guess she's not here yet. This is written by Karen Klein, who is one of those wonderful family members who's also a friend, and she was she's a bunch of things. She's a dancer, she was a professor at Brandeis, she's done a lot of things. Hi, I'm your blue mask. When I look in the mirror, I see stickers. Faith, understanding, courage, peace, all good stuff. Cover my face for the world to see. But what's inside the mask? What do you see that the world doesn't? Something happened that made you put me on and color me blue. If you're hurting, I wish I had arms to hug you. If you cry, please give me ears to hear you. But I'll go back to the mirror to see something I hope you do a lot. When you do, please stroke my face so I know you're out there kicking butt.
So before we start the poetry readings, there's two people I want to recognize. They really helped me navigate this. One, Mr. Timothy Reed. He got the art to the poets. So the poets were able to pick out a piece of art. Tim Reed organized that whole thing. So much applause to Tim Reed. Is Ann Beauregard here? Ann? I know she was here. Ann Beauregard. I try to navigate the publicity part of it, but Ann was the ship that went through the iceberg. We have Brockton Cable, we have Brockton Enterprise, the talking information channel, Spark the News is here. And without Ann, none of that would have happened. So much applause to Ann Beauregard. So here we go. Please welcome to the mic, to the Zen mic, Louise Derry Wells, artist Elizabeth Trull. Please turn to page 3.
Well, I'm so happy to be invited today.
And when I saw the wonderful artworks, I just could not decide which one to pick. So I said, what is your favorite thing? One of my favorite things is the cardinal. I love cardinals because to me they're a symbol of courage. So Elizabeth's cardinal, I think Elizabeth is back there, and she and I met before the exhibit today. And I was telling her how much I love fairy tales. And I was imagining that that cardinal was sitting up in a tree watching Hansel and Gretel try to make their way through the forest and try to get home. And that's where my poem comes from today. It's called A String of Courage. Sometimes only courage can trace its way through dark forest. Hansel dropped crumbs of his last piece of bread on the path and hopes he and little Gretel could follow this trail back home. Luckily, it was a cardinal who ate them and sketched with his beak a picture of returning life in meandering lines the witch could not see, but opened innocent eyes of good children could. Thank you.
Thank you, Louise. Next up, Mr. Alva Howe, artist Mark Ziarbro, page 32.
I'm very happy to be here. The picture that goes with my poem is the big one on the wall next to the door. I came in, I thought maybe it was going to be a little small thing because I had only seen it in a little screen. And I looked all over the place, and finally I gave up and looked at the big one, and that was it. And I got to tell you, I wanted to do a rooster because it's the year of the rooster in the Chinese calendar. And I wound up doing all this research on Chinese astronomy and Chinese astrology and chickens and symbols of chickens. And I had like a stack of 12 books that I had to go through to pull information out of. But one really thing stood out for me. When I took this off the website, it's got the number 68. And the constellation in the Chinese calendar is sometimes Taurus in the Western calendar. And I looked at Taurus in my star maps, and there's a star labeled 68. So I did this poem in the person of the rooster. This is his year. He's the fire rooster. He's going to just light your world on fire. It's called That Watcher Wise, Chinese Year of the Fire Rooster. Out of the first spring thaw, a spotless ladybug, a burbling beetle, lands before me. Its russet back reveals it. Quicker than it can flit, I pounce. A lucky fortune cookie. I am the alert watchcock of the yard, the ash tree topper, the steeple rider, bright gleam of hard work and industry. My spurs are the swords and scimitars of a safe coop. No ghostly owl, no whispery falcon drone shall fleck my flock with bloody talons. I am secret keeper, promise holder, observer, the cock-a-doodle-doo bird, rooster. I admit it. I like to dress up, handsome as I am. Check out the crimson of my primaries lined with oxblood, the cardinal secondaries with their doeskin crown, the sharp, inflexible hackles decked in flame and top. The long curved copper sickles of my tail, my hot mandarin comb. My heart is beating in a thatched coral breast. In the dark of night, I take my post, sentinel of the purple east, where bare branches silhouette upon pale violet. The screen turns honey, the clouds butter and cream, then lemon shifts, suffuse the sky, blush turn canary yellow. Not till I cry the fifth time is my match alight, a stellar burst of dandelion. Chrome buses and saffron saturates the morning glare. The yoke of the dawn salutes me. Why not? I stood by Leto when the sun was born. I ran the boundaries with wing-footed Mercury. With feathered wings arise that watch our wise.
Thank you, Alva. A warm welcome after she gets done with her interview. Nancy Brady Cunningham, artist, Joanne C., page 4.
Oh, thanks, Phil, and thanks to everybody that set this up today. This is just beautiful. So, is Joanne C. here? Not here? Okay. I picked the picture of the wolf out of the selections, and only today did I see the title that Joanne had given to the painting. And the title is Save Us. And my poem is A Pawnee Prayer to the Wolf. So I see some synchronicity there. Save us and a prayer. Maybe it's just me. I don't know, but I see some coordination there. You move like liquid across the land. Your eyes see distances 2 looks away. Your ears hear a cloud passing overhead. You live in the shadow places, arriving at sunset at forest's edge. You long for darkness. I put the wolf skin on. It slides over my shoulders like a cloak. The wolf head rests against my hair, ears pointing up. I pick up the rattle. The heartbeat in my wrist pulses, wolf. I trot around the campfire, my eyes ablaze. Through the fur, I draw down the spirit of wolf. The howling begins. It rides the cold wind, frozen music in winter air. I am wolf. I use my ears to taste deep waters of silence. I use my nose to look where there's nothing to see. I face the wind. I mend my tribe. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. Next up to the podium, Mr. Craig Fredericks, artist, Michelle Dempsey. Is Michelle here? No. Page 11.
My mom likes to tell the story about how on the way back from the hospital, I was born in the South Shore Hospital in Weymouth. So that's how far I've come in life, probably 20 miles. But on the way back, they stopped at D.W. Fields Park. They wanted to show me the ducks. So that was my first experience outside the hospital. And she brought me here back when I was 2 or 3. My dad worked for Liberty Mutual, which was in the white building right in the center of town back in the 60s. And I remember the lobby here. I mean, it wasn't just 2 and 3 for a while. But so anyway, it's good to be back. This isn't my first time back since then. I was here last year, but good to be back here. Hi. I like to pair the food I eat with the trees where I dine. So I'll eat like popcorn in a maple and cones round the pine. And here on the common with food and branches and quick reach, snacks, especially cheesy, go best with the old copper beech. Look, fresh crowd of people in red, white, and blue. I smell another parade for the Pats. Last week it was woman with clever signs and a clue, all friendly except squirrels don't much trust cats, and so it took a sec to take to all the pussy hats. Above sidewalk now, just side Tremont, wicked awesome viewing place, duck boat rolling under, I get a good look. Oops, nuts, confetti in the face. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Craig. Please welcome Chris Zaramba, artist, Rhonda M., page 5.
Thank you for inviting me to this event. I always love to have fun with words. My poem's called As Free as a Bird. He whistled and I'd come running. He was my male visitor, a charmer in his colorful feather coat, always with a shiny gift. This time he brought me a rainbow. He told me his stories and a song before finally settling down to the food I had put out for him. And he would drink. Yes, he loved a good drink. Then another story, flying off the handle to make a point, diving into it, circling around, and then another drink, of course. A good friend, but a free spirit. Never to be caught by a woman, never to be caged. He'll always be flying off to some place I can only imagine. The sky above him, the wind to his back, a song in his heart. Oh, to be free as a bird.
Thank you, Chris. Mr. James G.H. Moore, artist, Terry Sweeney, page 30.
I didn't know this was going to be so convenient that the picture and the poem would be together, so I brought some supplies, but I'm not going to read them. And by the way, when you're reading, this mic is for the camera. Terry Sweeney's photo, Today's Yesterday, called out to me, I guess you can say, silently. It said, you know, this is a moment, this is a photograph, this is a passage. Do something with that. So I did. Still light and passage. The two are always walking from light to light, through dramatic shadows in the arched passage. In their labor of slouched shoulders, side by side, each is different, each is similar in their journey. Confident of the outcome, they know they will pass back and forth many times, making conversation, which, though incomplete in the visualized moment, is always new, always known. The arched stone wall separates them from what they have passed on the bridge as the two move resolutely through the ungated way to a courtyard and ancient trees under the same sky. The foreground bridge, open and moist after rain, holds a perspective framing open movement through which healing can be found, always on the other side, on each side. There are always two walking from light to light.
Mr. James Moore, another applause, please. Next up to the mic, please welcome Dana Rowe. Artist, Karen Page Dash, right here. Could you stand up, Karen? Just as a warning, she's going to be standing up a couple of more times. Page 29.
I have to say, that painting jumped off the computer screen at me. We got a whole collection of all these works, and we had to click through and choose one. And as soon as that opened on the screen, I knew that was going to be it. I went through the rest just to make sure, which I always do, but that one was it. And it's just the look in the women's eyes was saying something, saying a lot. Grim determinants, eyes searching within time frame, with thousand-mile gaze toward uncertain futures. Results failed to match the vote. Lifestyles losses perceived. Promises redirected. Throwing chaos into lives, leadership changes determine uncertainty. Facing grim alternatives, misery broadcast from eyes.
Thank you, Dana. Please welcome to the podium Mr. John Holgerson, artist Elizabeth Trull, page 12.
I just want to thank Philip for inviting me to participate in this project. Thank you very much. I chose this particular work of art because butterflies, for me, embody or epitomize the fragility and ethereality of beauty. And initially, I saw something joyous and celebratory in this particular work of art. But the more I studied it and the more I started to write about it, it was really something else that I saw beneath it. And when I finished the poem, I read it to my most severest critic, my wife, who told me that it's a sad poem. And I said, I think that's what's under all of the bright colors and wingspread of this particular work of art. At least that's what spoke to me. The poem is called Butterfly Heart. Her heart is a battered butterfly, floating from one inconstant lover to another, looking for compassion and honesty while keeping its own undercover. Anonymous, she lets it flit time away in a garden of chat rooms she grows online, talking about sad and broken moments, some quite profane, some quite divine. And in her nights of solitude, quiet but for some soft sighing, her heart finds solace in the simple fact, no one can hear a butterfly crying. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Please welcome Elizabeth Hansen, artist, Karen Page Dash, page 29.
This particular painting is in the corner there. It's a lovely, lovely piece. And this wonderful artist I chose last time. Yes, yep. So I guess I really love your work. This, again, I did not see the title. So I made up a title. So this one I'm calling Soar. Save us from this world of waiting. Save us from the lethargic longing of stillness, no longer mute. But like water running from the tap down the drain, insistent into cities of silence, I too soar above my body, past monochromatic, postmodern, the grid, this tether of pain, of nothingness, enough space to soar. Timeless in my need, pulled, hunkering down, I wait. I have always waited. I wait, hunkering down. I wait. I have always waited. I wait.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Please welcome to the podium Nancy Morgan Boucher, artist Kevin Korab, page 6.
Something about the face of this painting that drew me in. I found it a challenge, but it all came to me. It's called Shocked, the Day After. It's a washout, orange, pink, sherbet, frazzled slurry, psychedelic, segmented synapses, brain breached, botched. Turn to page 2. This is the day after. Dabble, dithered, differentiation, detected divergent affect. Clown, sad clown, give me a smoke. No affect, that's all. Outcome, if I had a body, I would have no place to put it.
Thank you, Nancy. I know the next reader has no problem projecting. And if the name sounds the same, it's the husband of Nancy. Please welcome Roger Boucher, artist Ashley Higgins, page 14.
First off, thank you, Philip, for bringing me back for year 2. My 2 years. And thank you to Ashley Higgins also for her colorful bird. I named the bird Fancy Bird. Fragments of blue in breaking away uncover new life, much like an eggshell in the eons of time. This feathered fantasy has a message as it bursts through the blue. Steal the time in those quiet moments to feel with new eyes. Its habits are formed with deliberate intention. Visualize this fanciful colored creation as often as a hug is desired. It's okay to love the moment. This party colored sensation is portrayed by our artist as an imaginary rescuer of an overstressed life. Weighted down by its own weariness. The art piece, in trying to remove layers of sadness, helps us to embrace our most sensitive and innermost feelings of clear-headedness. Take care of yourself. Fancy Bird is a vivid delight you can identify with. Her message is uplifting, and the only thing real about her is the way she appears to you. Residing in another dimension, she is perfect for breaking down barriers, leading the way through a time of despair, seeing with new eyes. In a quiet time of reflection, this feathered make-believe can restore an expectancy of faith, a smile of strength and discovery.
So our next reader, Mr. Tim Reed, has 2 poems. The first, artist Elliot Sam Doan, page 9. And the second poem will be artist Sandy D, page 21. Tim Reed.
The first piece I titled Listen for the music, because it's this beautiful cascade of vivid colors, and right in the middle of it, all I could see was what appeared to be a G clef. Listen for the music. Can you hear the music? Listen for it. Songs woven into the tapestry of the arts, binding each of its parts into one as a whole, freeing the soul to hear the tone and melody cascading in harmony as vibrant crescendos of color blend at the treble clef's suggestion, blurring the borders of segregation where there should be none. For it is all, we are all one and the same, a rose by any other name. The paint or the word, the spoken, seen or heard, the ocean's breathing wakes as each wave breaks upon a crimson shore, as warm breeze humbles you to your knees, silent in the moment, or elates you to dance and sway, frolic or play to the rhythmic beat of the arts, dwelling in the hearts of those who listen for the music. Paint your poem, sculpt your song, or dream your dance in a symphony of splendor. To thine own self be true. It is up to you. Listen for the music. And the second piece is from the Mask Project, and it's the black and white mask back there, which I immediately saw yin and yang. And I tend to do a lot of introspective writing. This mask of balance is all I put forth, all I truly seek. This balance of which I speak, this balance I teach of and preach of, is merely a mask of yin and yang, which I hide behind, worn only to adorn the facade of chaos and fear that lives here. My life does not happen in one, two, three order, you see. It comes at me in disordered groupings like 6, 9, and 3 all at one time. No reason, no rhyme. Yet outwardly, I sail on even keel, while within, gasping and grasping for one breath of balance. So I ask, am I wrong to adorn this mask? Be the change you want to see. Will it set me free from the chaos? No. But God surely lives in my heart, in my art, within, and this brings me balance, my place to retreat as such, when it all seems just too much. A place to dwell with yin and yang, the darkness never without light, and the light never without dark. Hark, the balance of knowing that one without the other leaves either as neither. Sometimes you have to fake it to make it, to find the balance between faith and fear, between chaos and calm. Is that too much to ask from this mask of balance? Thank you.
Thank you, Timothy. Next up to the mic, we have poet and artist, or artist poet. Linda Almeyer, page 36.
Hi, a lot of people I know. Okay, this is my first time, so bear with me. It's called Dreams. Daydreaming, it is called during the light of day. Why is it not called night dreaming? Sometimes the images are fun and daring. Sometimes the images are dark and caring. The main thing of unconscious thought is the fact of waking up.
And that was at the spur of the moment. I mean, I just asked Linda like a few minutes ago, and she got up and pulled it off. Please welcome to the microphone Mr. Richard Berg, artist, Karen Page Dash, page 27.
Don't think you're going to get away with sitting down, Karen. How about Karen, stand up. I also saw your piece and was drawn to it. And I looked through all of them, Dana, and just to make sure, Dana, and came back to it and said, no, that's my piece. But I have to reply to it right away before someone else takes it. Interestingly enough, and thank you everybody for putting this on and showing up, this is fabulous. My piece is titled Right on Time, which of course I got here on time. But I thought I had my piece in my tablet. And everybody that knows me, I always keep technology and I always keep everything in my tablet and my phone, a double redundant system. It's not there. I also have a little bit of trouble reading from paper, and I don't keep my hand still and it shakes and I can't read from small print, and I didn't have it printed. I do have my mega glasses and my smaller glasses. But my friend over here was kind enough to pull the actual piece so I could read it. Because I can't read it from my tablet and I can't read it from the booklet. So anyways, I'll just get to my poem. Right on time. I'm usually super organized. Yeah. Until cognitive processes mismatch. Right now, I have to make a first impression meeting a gallery owner at a chic cafe. 20 minutes early, a spot in front. That was easy. Only to be informed, I'm sorry, Mr. Berg, the reservation is for tomorrow. And walk out with my head spinning. I went to the right place at the wrong time, which makes it the wrong place this time. Reeling in emotional overload, I try to salvage the rest of the day and stop thinking about the last time this time was gonna be the last this time. I think that in my dream, by the way. A plethora of technology at my fingertips, and I'm still missing things. Do people really get mad if you don't get back to them for a day or two? A week? A month? Turns out the cafe scenario is more than discombobulated scheduling. Medically speaking, it's chronic disorganization, commonly associated with depression, PTSD, chronic pain, sleep disorders, and brain injury. For these people, myself included, nothing is routine. Everyday decisions can become complex. Despite this impingement in cognitive function, this melee of discorded neurological signaling, eventually, I get over the emotional roller coaster. There's no cure for MTBI, mild traumatic brain injury, and the myriad of complications that come with it. What it comes down to is what we make of it. I'm used to taking on the world, and I have no intention of changing. The upshot of all this, I'm better at being me than I ever was. Timing is everything, and our time is now. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rich Berg. Next up to the podium, Dr. James Bronson, two poems. First poem, artist, Nathan Carr, page 16. Is Nathan here? Nathan? Nathan's right there. And second poem, Tracy Tarvis, page 17, and I know Tracy's here also.
Thank you very much. I'm happy to be here this year. I managed to get my teaching schedule changed a little so that I could make it here from Providence. So the first one, the first painting by Nathan, has the stars in it, and you will notice that in the poem there are some stars. And the other thing about the poem is that the title of the poem sort of runs into the poem itself. So this evening at dusk, as I dabble in narrative verse while staring at the beaver moon through the kitchen window, my mind descends into familiar landscapes of browning timothy, bordered by dark silhouettes of 60-foot white pines, sentinels watching the leading edge of darkness spill over a tangerine swirled horizon. It's what I remember when we hiked along the cold river of lengthening shadows, the place where I held your hand as we stopped to guess the names of stars. And the second painting by Tracy sort of drew me because in my spare time, I'm always along the main coast. So as I looked at that, I imagined that this was something off the coast and I could see the ship and the glare of lighthouse, etc. So I call this one Rumors of Silence. I am usually mesmerized by broad raspberry brushstrokes etched across western horizons, but that August morning, before we climbed the garnet-tossed path hand in hand to view pounding Atlantic surf, my attention was drawn to a distant lighthouse whose beam pulsated from rocky outcroppings in the dense fog, a half mile beyond the wind-blown clumps of beach grass edging the dunes where we stood, our silhouettes lost in silent music. Thank you.
Thank you, James. Next up to the mic is Sheila Twyman, artist Sandy Demarauville. Page 11.
I have to put some context into my poem. I chose that cute little seahorse there. And in 1906, a German doctor named Eloy Alzheimer first described a dementia. He had treated a woman who died at age 51, and the disease, of course, was named after him, Alzheimer's disease. He described amyloid plaques and tau neurofibrillaries, tangles and plaques in the brain. And when these plaques attack the hippocampus region of the brain, that's when you lose your memory. Now, the hippocampus is shaped just like a seahorse. In fact, if you place a dissected hippocampus from the brain next to a seahorse, they're shaped exactly alike. You're shaking your head, you know, okay. And I chose that because of this delightful little thing. It's really cute. It's called the Border War. Brazened hoofed horses gallop hell-bent across great seas of consciousness. Poseidon has lost the reins. He cannot navigate the cognitive space. His hippocampi roil and heave the neural circuits, fragment the beta amyloid, trample them to misshapen plaques, stampede across microtubules, scatter neurofibrillaries, devour the tau. Their hunger will not be sated. Memories cannot be untangled.
Thank you.
Do you want to introduce?
Page 34. You got it?
Yep, I have it. Okay. Now, I'm going to do the next poem. The poet is Joanna Nealon, and the artist is Sandy Topalian. And her painting is right up there on the wall. It's quite beautiful. Joanna, I must tell you about Joanna. She's blind. She lost her sight when she was 19 years old, and it was gradual. She married a man who was also blind. He lost his sight in college during a chemistry experiment, which exploded and just took out his eyes. All he has are white orbs. And the two of them actually met while going to school in Europe. Can you imagine that? Two blind people going off all by themselves to Europe and happening to meet. Joanna's poem is called, It's a Hard Thing. It's a hard thing never to look, never to look into the dreaming lake nearby with birch stretched white and quivering across the water, and the green made greener at the lake's fresh edge. But harder still is never to look into those depths, deeper than lakes, eyes.
So I want to explain a little bit about Joanna's poem, because a lot of you are going, well, if she's blind, how did she see the painting? So Sandy came up with this great idea for some of the poets to send short poems to the Brain Injury Association, and she passed them out to some of the survivors and caregivers, and they created a piece of art on the poem. So that's how that was done. So Sandy created that piece from reading Joanna's poem.
And the rest of them are all up on this corner. This was all the reverse process.
Next to the podium, please welcome Mr. Bill Alberti, artist Karen Page Dash. Page 28.
Well, Karen stood up that time. Thanks, Karen. I had asked if the artist was here earlier, and they said that you weren't here, so because I really wanted to meet you and talk about your painting. I have to thank Phil again for inviting me. It's a pleasure and honor to be here and being able to write a poem for this group. I want to thank Tim Reed for pushing me to figure out how to go on Facebook and find all these paintings. So I amazed and stupefied myself that I was able to do it. And when I ran through, the paintings were just, all of them were just wonderful. But this one called to me because I was born in New York City. And we're on number 28. And Karen has done a pen and ink sketch here of an iconic figure in New York. As Woody Nelson once wrote, "Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. Don't let them pick guitars and drive them old trucks. Let them be doctors and lawyers and such." Midday cowboy. Desperado, why don't you come to your senses? Glenn Frey and Don Henley. In this well-rendered pen and ink sketch, the artist has captured the naked cowboy, posed beneath the soaring skyscrapers of the Big Apple's Times Square. Bob Burke, the buff Broadway busker, moseys along 7th Avenue's pedestrian pathway between 44th and 45th, corralled by city slickers and out-of-town tourists. He's nearly nude in white Stetson and Western boots, but dread not. A patriotic painted acoustic guitar hangs down from his neck to strategically cover the fruits of his loom in tidy whities. He stands and smiles, face framed by shoulder-length bleached hair, and strums the strings of his instrument to lasso the crowd's attention. 9 years, this Cincinnati-born cowpoke has been street performing, panhandling and posing for pictures. Pocketless, he tucks tips into his boots. Every day, in all kinds of weather, this Midtown minstrel Adonis makes music and money, amusing himself and the masses. But I can't smirk or laugh at the dude, because this now trademarked New York City fixture, beloved of the lassies and ladies, earns $150,000 a year. Giddy up, buckaroo. Now, where did I put my guitar?
Thank you, Bill. Next poet is me. So I have three poems. The first poem is by Elizabeth Trull, page 19. A little bit about how I came about this poem. I saw the two masks and was immediately drawn to the movies. Remember the mask of the movies? And then the bright, vibrant pink, and then the other mask was like the drawn out beige, just the life drawn out of it. And I automatically like wrote this poem, sent it to Tim, as a matter of fact, and just to kind of get his feedback, and told him, because this has to be the quickest I've ever written a poem. It took me like 20 minutes and it was done. But that's the effect that the masks had on me. Act One. We sit alone, voices silent, reacting, resisting. Lines spoken, invisible to naked eye. We substitute masks out of possessions. The stillness betrays our bodies. The dance, still stagnant. We reach out, indifferent. Directions, flawed. Seeking cues as we lose our place, missing the mark, the desire, the passion, now covered in blank page. You move left, I move on, exit right. Intermission. Act Two. You run to the edge, arms thrown out in desperate prayers, tears spilling, droplets explode in crescendo of voiceless screams. You wanted to jump. The great death scene. I let you. The only way it could have ended. Fini. The second poem, where am I? Page 35 by Kevin Korab. Again, I took part in the exercise of sending a short poem, and Kevin made the art for this poem. And it's called First Snow. As we know, we had plenty of it, not too much, but just enough this year. First snow. Drop shovel into fresh fallen snow. Push. Inhale crisp air. Sense the consciousness. Infinite flakes against face. Atmosphere bends, senses pour into lungs, spills to tingle toes. Twilight falling to the scent of pink roses, remembrance of summer's warmth. In time, quiets the timbre of my being. Exhale, relish the illumination in this beautiful moment. And the last poem, okay. Remember how we applauded for Anne Beauregard and she wasn't here? She's here. So let's give Anne a big hand. So this last poem, I tell you, I was very honored because Sandy called me and said that the group did a group art piece and they wanted me to do the poem for it. So I am truly honored and inspired. As all the poets will tell you, inspiration is all through this exhibit. The group Mosaic Artists and the page is 33. The artist taking part in this group picture, Linda Morin Elmer, Nathan Carr, Elliot Sam Doan, Thomas Fay, Lorraine Kirk, Kevin Korab, Corey Levine, Amy Simmons, and Elizabeth Troll. The art picture is called All You Need Is Love. The poem is called All You Need Is Love. The heart lays still, stillness of my mind, exhale. Feel the gentle breeze against my reality. Gray surroundings that encased me now brighten the day with colors, give rise to the symphony, colors thrown at the heart, call to mind stories, you and I. Memories fall into teardrops, into raindrops. The heart flows in silhouette, wait for you to wash over me. Listen to the rhythm that unites us. I inhale multiple colors, all the while inhaling you. Do our hearts crack these tiny fractures? Do we coexist with colors mingled? The human condition does not tell truths or lies, but the moment, the now. We make our faith a new language, inhaling multiple colors, clinging to the air, waiting to be held between us. Like butterflies ascending aloft in the air, colors and sounds multiplying, all you need is love. Butterflies begin to flutter, whose wings are violins. Okay. Before we wrap this up, there's someone I want to introduce. He just walked into the building, so he has no idea he's going to be called upon. And he's kind of back there chatting. But he's from Brockton High. The booklets that you see, Brockton High students did all this. They put the whole thing together. So please welcome David Halloum.
First, I'd just like to say we're honored to be able to do this year. This was done by 15, 16, and 17-year-old kids. And none of them showed up, by the way. I don't know if you got the phone calls, but one of my kids wrote a poem, and it's with this mask. And I hope you like it. And she herself has had, a lot of my kids have had a rough lives. Aaron Tinney designed the book. He did the primary design. He's about 16 and was just admitted into Mass Art. So again, this is an honor for him, for us, and I just hope everybody enjoys it. And you people are great for even being here. So thank you. Take care.